Well, good morning, Peace Church. It's good to be gathered with you once again as we celebrate what God is doing in this new place, a new time. We're in the season of Epiphany, where God's light is shining upon the world, and we just invite you into that spirit of the day as we gather and celebrate God's light upon us all. A few announcements we do want to share with you. We're still looking for some virtual scripture readers. We invite you, if you have an interest in providing a video of a scripture reading, to please let us know. Call the church office. Let Debbie or Claire know. We'll get those appropriate scriptures out to you so you can share them as part of our service. We're also asking you to watch in the mail for information about our upcoming 2021 budget. We're not going to have an official congregational meeting, but we're going to be sending out all the information about the budget and the year-end financial information, and we're going to be asking people to vote either by phone or by email so that we can approve our 2021 budget. Later in the year, when we can be back together, we'll call our congregation back together and have that official meeting. But until then, we invite you to read all the material, to really consider the gifts for 2021 so we can set our budget and move forward. We also want to let you know what's going on with our upcoming faith formation drive-by. So Winston, tell us about that.
Yeah, so pretty simple setup for next week, next Sunday, the 24th. We're going to be having the mission boxes be passed out. So if you're registered with our Peace Powers and you want to continue on with the journey to defeat Brick Brain, then come on by. It's from 11:30 to 12:30 to pick up the mission boxes. We'll have them all ready for you. If you're registered, come on by. And if you're not registered, shoot me an email, contact me. You can find all that information on our website, and we'll get you registered.
Thanks for all your work with that. If you've not had a chance to check out some of the videos, please do so on the Peace Church website as well. We do want to lift up some of our prayer concerns and joys today as we gather together. First of all, prayer for our country as we go through a transition coming up. There's been a lot of turmoil, so just prayers for our country for peace to prevail. We also want to lift up continuing prayers for the Bolios and their recovery, and as they do their rehab work and get back into the fold, we give thanks for the healing presence there. For Stevie Hallisey as well, as she continues to recover from her fall. We do want to lift up Ed Wagner, who underwent surgery and has also returned home. For Sue Crowley, who is awaiting her surgery, and prayers and blessings with her. And then for Mary Ely and Bill Meinhardt recovering from their surgery. So a lot of people doing doing well, so we give thanks for that. Most importantly, we just invite God's Spirit to be upon everyone, wherever they are, whether grieving or hurting or needing a healing prayer or just filled with abundant joy. We just give thanks for God's presence here in this place, because we're all gathered together to hear God's word and to proclaim that good news for all the world until the world hears.
Heart and see the world through your eyes. calling out, lifting up your name for all to hear the sound. My voice is in the wilderness, we're crying out. As the day draws near, we'll sing until the whole world hears. Whoa.
Beautiful song. Our first scripture this morning is from Micah chapter 6 verse 8. God has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does God require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. Let us pray. God of our ancestors and God of our dreams, we gather today to remember that you have created us all in your image and in your likeness.
And so we still have the courage to dream the impossible.
We remember how you spoke into the darkness and created light.
And so we still have the courage to dream the impossible.
We remember the ways you have delivered your people through trials and tribulations since the beginning of time, right up until this present moment.
And so we still have the courage to dream the impossible.
You have confronted us through the middle passage, racism, segregation, stripped identities, and unjust laws.
And so we still have the courage to dream the impossible.
God, you have been the guiding light along the paths of hope and love, leading toward a beloved community where all are equally seen and radically loved.
And so we still have the courage to dream the impossible.
We gather today remembering your presence amongst us and the call to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with you and our neighbors. Lord God, we pray this morning. We're in a difficult moment in our country and in the world facing this global pandemic, and we pray for all those on the front lines, all those who are hurting, who have lost loved ones, who have endured financial struggles. We pray especially in this moment for the political unrest in our country, and we place our hearts in your hands this morning in this difficult moment in our lives. We trust that despite all of the difficulty, that we remember your promise that you are with us always to the end of time. And so we pray as you taught us and remember, saying, our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now we're going to hear a message from myself about continuing we're learning about David and Goliath and the story of that and how that connects with our peace powers theme. So hope you enjoy the message. Hey kids, Pastor Winston here. So last week, you guys heard the full story of David and Goliath, and I hope you all enjoyed that. Now this story has been told for thousands of years, and a lot of people draw inspiration from it. They think to themselves, you know, what are the Goliaths in our life, right? It might be a big problem we're facing that we're really afraid of and intimidated by. And
We think of ourselves as the hero of the story, David, the underdog, the one who's going to overcome the challenges that seem too great, but in the end will be victorious, right? So it's a beautiful way of thinking about the problems that we face in life, that we can overcome these great challenges that really scare us, but we can be courageous, you know, like Ben was explaining to us, and be able to overcome those challenges. And at the same time, I think as we're talking this month about loving ourselves, what does it mean to love ourselves? We have to think about this story that Goliath can be seen as a bully, right? And we do, as kids and even as grownups, deal with bullies sometimes in our lives. And so it was a very different time in history, right, when David had to fight Goliath. People sometimes resolved conflict through violence and through fighting, right? But I think it's worth noting that that's not always the way that we should solve things in today's world, right? We can get in big trouble if we're violent and fight like that. So we have to think, how do we respond when people bully us? And that has a lot of connection to how we feel about ourselves, because oftentimes when people bully us, it might not even be violent. It might be just something they're saying to us that makes us not feel good about ourselves, that makes us feel bad about ourselves. They might say that we're not good, or that we stink at doing certain things and stuff like that, that are really not nice and make us not feel good about ourselves once again. So how do we respond to that? And we want to think, like, in today's world, we need to think of ways to respond differently. So you might just think about, you know, when we meet a bully, is hurting them really the best solution? Probably not in today's world, right? Things are very different. What are some other ways that we can deal with bullies? Well, we might want to reach out to a grown-up for help. We might want to reach out to our friends. If they're around, we might walk away or tell the bully strongly and confidently to stop, or, you know, ask them to have empathy and say, you know, how would you feel if someone was treating you this way? We want to believe in ourselves and be strong and stand up to the bullies sometimes. But we also have to realize that in every situation, it could be a little different. Maybe the best thing is to run away, to get help from a grown-up, especially if you see someone else getting bullied. You might want to call for help or step in and support that person who's being bullied and say, hey, this is not okay what you're doing, and we're not going to allow that, right? We all have to help each other and keep each other accountable sometimes, to treat each other in a good way, in the right way. And that's what we're taught largely. That's why we learn from Jesus, right? To treat our neighbors in a loving way, and to stand up against injustice and those kind of things. So we might also want to reflect on what makes people act like bullies. Why do people act like this sometimes? It's easy to kind of make people into the enemy and say, well, they're just bad people. But we sometimes want to remember bullies might sometimes act that way because of what they're feeling inside. Maybe they're feeling, you know, lonely. I mean, I'm sure it can't feel good when they're mean to other people. They might act that way, but sometimes bullies are also feeling, you know, hurt inside or lonely or not good about themselves. So sometimes, you know, when we all try to befriend one another, that can be helpful as well. So there's no easy answer to all this, but I just wanted to encourage you all to think about different ways we can respond to bullies than the way that David responded to Goliath, even though we get a lot of inspiration from that story. So if we want to also turn this week to our craft, is going to be a box of affirmations. So what that means is that we want to ask our grown-ups, our family, our friends, what are some things that you think are good about me? Maybe some memories you have of something you did that you were proud of. And you want to use your piece of paper in there. You can cut slips of paper up and just write on those things that make you feel good about yourself and proud. And you can collect those things that other people have said about you that you're proud of, and the things they like and love about you. And you can collect them and put them in a box so that sometimes if you're really not feeling good about yourself that day, not feeling confident, not it's being a little bit hard to love yourself, you can look in that box and remind yourself of all the reasons why you are a good person and a beautiful person, worthy of love, and that you should have a good sense of being proud of yourself and loving yourself. All right. So I hope you all enjoy that this week, and I look forward to talking to you next time. Go Peace Powers.
Well, we thank Pastor Winston for that message in our ongoing superhero series for our children and for us adults too, as we engage and celebrate with that. I want to share with you our gospel scripture today, and it comes from John. We're continually moving forward as we begin our new year, and now we're jumping to the Gospel of John as we begin this Epiphany season. From John 1, chapter 43. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. There he found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. And Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses and the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." And Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" And Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." Well, I give thanks for that scripture for us today and the opening scripture that Pastor Winston read from Micah 6:8. Today I just wanted to take some time and really dig into what it means to be called by God in this world in which we live. Because God can be our guiding star, our guiding light. And in our opening prayer, the one phrase that really warmed me is the line, "God, you have been our guiding light along the paths of hope and love, all leading toward a beloved community where all are equally seen and radically loved." What better words are there for us today to begin our time together when we think about God's light that comes pouring into our world and into our lives? Now, I thought about this light, and I went back to one of my favorite Christmas songs, "Do You Hear What I Hear?" Now, Tom and Kathy Otten did a beautiful rendition of that for us on Christmas Eve. If you've not had a chance to hear that, I invite you to go to that Christmas Eve service and listen to that beautiful song. And it begins with these words, "The night wind asking the little lamb, do you see what I see? I see a star dancing in the night with a tail as big as a kite. Then the little lamb asks the shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear? I hear a song high above the trees with a voice as big as a sea. Then the shepherd boy asks the mighty king, do you know what I know? I know that in your warm place there is a child who shivers in the cold. We must bring him silver and gold." And then the song concludes with the king saying to the people everywhere, "Listen to what I say. Pray for peace. Pray for peace, people everywhere. Listen to what I say. The child sleeping in the night, he will bring us goodness and light." Beginning with the light of a dancing star, just barely observable in the dark night sky, the song becomes more and more embodied. With each successive verse, that star becomes a song, which becomes a voice, which becomes a child whose life makes all the difference in the world for generation upon generation and for us today. Why? Because this little baby, all grown up now, shows us what it looks like literally and physically and tangibly to really practice what the love of God is all about. Jesus shows us in his life and in his choices and in his teaching and in his words and in his actions. Jesus shows us what it's like for him to be the very best that he can be, to share love to all the people, and in doing so, he shows us how we can be the very best that God calls us to be. And our journey begins. Each and every one of us begins with a beautiful call. You know, we are fortunate, I believe. We're fortunate to be a part of a religious tradition that has always understood that the call of God is not just for us clergy people, us people who are ordained, but God calls each and every person. Our tagline is, every member is a minister. And I truly believe that. The priesthood of all believers, that we are all called to serve in this world. And for the next couple of Sundays, we're going to explore what that call looks like for you and for me. And today we begin with that familiar scene that for the first disciples really started it all. So this baby Jesus now is all grown up, and we hear Jesus' voice, two simple words, follow me. Now Jesus is calling together this ragtag band of followers that would eventually come to change the world. And in that general process, Jesus issues a very specific call to Philip, who immediately, and that word immediately is found in so many of those call passages, immediately Philip goes home and he connects with his brother Nathanael to come and to see this prophet of God. So when Nathanael hears that the so-called prophet is from Nazareth, he really does not want to hear anymore. Nathanael's view is clear. No good can possibly come from Nazareth. Nazareth, that poor town of destitute carpenters and low-scale laborers, is kind of like somebody from Minnesota saying that there could be no good that comes from Iowa. They are beneath the dignity of him and his brother. And all of a sudden, Nathanael is no longer even interested in hearing anymore, tries to shut down. That same discomfort at hearing is sometimes true for us as well, is it not? We could talk with great conviction about the generalities of peace, of justice, of compassion. Yet when it means money out of our pockets or time out of our already overcommitted schedules or efforts beyond what we are already doing, well, then we may not want to hear anymore. We begin tuning out because we just think it's too much. Because you see, answering the call of God into our lives, no matter how uneasy or uncomfortable or inconvenient it is, it always begins with this powerful call. Now, I'm so proud of our United Church of Christ, which has always been at the forefront of hearing God's call and then bravely and boldly acting on that call, even when the cost has been great. We in the United Church of Christ have stood at the precipices of so many vital and important issues in our country and in our world, and we stood boldly, shoulder to shoulder, with all of our brothers and sisters, and I give thanks for that bold vision that calls us each and every day. And yet, even in the midst of that, we still struggle with issues. Today, this weekend, our nation honors the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., a pastor, a prophet, a political figure, one whose Christian faith was rooted in seeing the movement of God and listening for the ever-present call and voice of God. And as a result, Dr. King's actions was confidently settled in knowing the proclamation of the truth of God in the midst of all. His every speech, every sermon moved from the generalities of justice and peace to the particulars of just how those could be accomplished peacefully within the lives of the people in King's audience and the country. Now, I can remember when I was growing up, I was a young kid when this movement was taking place, but our TV was on and my dad boldly preached about it, and I heard story after story. I can remember that there were those, though, who really did not want to even hear what Dr. King had to say, what Reverend King had to preach, and sadly, most of that came from our white congregations. And even today, when Reverend Dr. Martin King's name is mentioned, or we lift up MLK on this weekend, many of our white Anglo churches either choose not to celebrate or they just close their ears to that message of love. Yet throughout his public life, Dr. King spoke out tirelessly against injustice as it was variously dressed in mid-20th century America. The right of all people to ride a bus, the right to freely vote, the right to strike for a living wage, the right to live in a better neighborhood, the right to send one's child to the best schools. All of these very specific issues of justice received Dr. King's attention. He spoke and he preached from the deepest places in his Christian soul of love and inclusion, convinced that it was Jesus himself who was providing that prophetic model for such preaching and such peaceful action. Now, this past week, our nation's capital was overcome by the other. Not by love and inclusion, but by hatred and white supremacy and insurrection that was stirred up to create chaos and division and, yes, even death itself. Oh, how we need to hear and speak the words of love today. Can we do less? This morning as we gather, as difficult as it may be, yet need now more than ever, I believe, I invite you to hear the words of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. again, delivered in our nation's capital from the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. His words incited love and compassion and equality, not hatred and division and hostility. And as we contemplate our call to follow in the ways of Jesus, I want you to hear these decade-old words from a brother in Christ, words that we have ignored for too long. Let's hear them today in new and powerful and moving ways. Hear Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King's words from 1963 for us today, from the voices of our loved ones from today and voices of tomorrow.
I am not unmindful that some of you have come here out of great trials and tribulations. Some of you have come fresh from narrow jail cells. Some of you have come from areas where your quest for freedom left you battered by the storms of persecution and staggered by the winds of police brutality. You have been the veterans of creative suffering. Continue to work with the faith that unearned suffering is redemptive. Go back to Mississippi, go back to Alabama, go back to South Carolina, go back to Georgia, go back to Louisiana, go back to the slums and ghettos of northern cities, knowing that somehow this situation can and will be changed. Let us not wallow in the valley of despair. I say to you today, my friends, so even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed.
We hold these truths to be self-evident,
that all people are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day, even in the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today that one day, down in Alabama, with this vicious racist, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification, one day, right there in Alabama, little black boys and little black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today.
I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted. Every hill and mountain shall be made low. The rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood and sisterhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day when all of God's children will be able to sing with a new meaning. My country, tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing, land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring.
And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. So let freedom ring from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire. Let freedom ring from the mighty mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania.
Let freedom ring from the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado. Let freedom ring from the curvaceous slopes of California. But not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee.
Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And when this happens, when we allow freedom to ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual.
Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
And amen. We give thanks for the McLaurin family for sharing those words with us today, because it's an inspiring restatement of the call of God in King's life. And the fact that it is steeped in and supported by King's own thought, word, and deed motivates us to hear, to rise up and respond to God's call in our lives for today, for our nation and world. But how to get there? How to get to that place of freedom, to that place of justice for all people, not just the wealthy? How to get to the place where brotherhood and sisterhood really is the law and the heart of the land. You see, we followers of Jesus know the answer to that. And Dr. King, as our Christian brother, later preached the answer on how to get there. And I invite you now to hear these words from another speech that was delivered at Riverside Church in New York City, which is an American Baptist and United Church of Christ church, just 1 year to the day before he was killed. There, King spoke of the only pathway that will take us toward that dream of justice and peace. The pathway is love. He said, "When I speak of love, I am not speaking of some sentimental and weak response. I am speaking of that force which all the great religions have seen as the supreme unifying principle of life. Love is somehow the key that unlocks the door which leads to ultimate reality. This Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Jewish, Buddhist belief about ultimate reality is beautifully summed up in the first epistle of St. John. Let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loves is of God and knows God. You see, we can no longer afford to worship the God of hate or bow before the altar of retaliation. We are now faced with the fact, my friends, that tomorrow is today. We are confronted with the fierce urgency of now. Now let us begin. Now let us rededicate ourselves to the long and bitter and beautiful struggle for a new world. This is the calling of the sons and daughters of God, and our brothers and sisters wait eagerly for our response, end quote. Now, decades after Reverend Dr. King preached at Riverside Church, hate and fear and loud voices, far too loud, are still here. And we may not want to hear Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King's message, words, because like Nathaniel, we may believe that no good can come from a namby-pamby, nonviolence fueled only by love. We may not want to hear Dr. King's words because they're going to require us, like Jesus, to hear them and to respond to God's call to love all despite it all. Yet I believe on a day like today, on this day, especially on a day like this, what's going on in our world, we are invited by God to hear precisely what we may not want to hear. That world that Dr. King described is still a dream. But we know how to make that dream a reality. The answer is simple, but it's not easy. And I believe that we do our part by rising up and stepping out in faith, one step at a time, to rise up and to hear and to realize the dream intoned by Dr. King by intentionally thinking about and doing peaceful solutions, to rise up and consciously take actions that bring justice, one attentive step at a time, to rise up like this.
You're broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you can't find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we're gonna walk it out and move mountains. We're gonna walk it out and move mountains, and I'll rise up, rise like the day. I'll rise up, I'll rise unafraid. I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. And I'll rise up, high like the waves. I'll rise up, in spite of the ache. I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you, for you, for you, for you. When the silence isn't quiet, and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe, and I know you feel like dying, but I promise we'll take the world to its feet and move mountains. Take it to its feet and move mountains. And I'll rise up, rise like the day. I'll rise up, I'll rise unafraid. I'll rise. each other in. We will rise, and we will rise, we'll rise, oh, 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 we'll rise. I'll rise up, rise like the day, I'll rise up in spite of the ache. I will rise a thousand times again, and we'll rise up, rise like the waves. We'll rise up in spite of the ache. We'll rise up, and we'll do it a thousand times again.
Amen. Thank you so many for sharing that beautiful song with us. And the words with it to rise up. I was reminded about that popular author, Anne Lamott, who once observed that stepping out in faith is like driving at night with your headlights on. You never see the entire road laid out before you, but you eventually get from point A to point B because the headlights provide just enough illumination to move forward from moment to moment. And the foundation of all our action is the faith in Christ as one who gave and loved and listened to even words he did not want to hear. Our faith is in Jesus, who shows us the way, one step of justice followed by another, one courageous act of resistance followed by another, one loving word and one compassionate deed followed by another and another and another. End quote. Years ago, our Presbyterian sisters and brothers, in answer to the question of how to hear and respond to God's call, wrote these powerful words. And I've shared them before, but I want to share them again with you in closing as a kind of a mantra, a personal statement of faith. It says this: I refuse to believe that we are unable to influence the events which surround us. I refuse to believe that we are unable to influence the events which surround us. I refuse to believe that we are so bound to racism and war that peace, brotherhood, and sisterhood are not possible. I believe there is an urgent need for people to overcome oppression and violence without resorting to violence and oppression. I believe that we need to discover a way to live together in peace, a way which rejects revenge, aggression, and retaliation. The foundation of this way is love. I believe that peoples everywhere could have three meals a day for their bodies, education and culture for their minds, and dignity, equality, and freedom for their spirits. By the goodness of God at work within people, I believe that brokenness can be healed. My friends, in this broken country that we are experiencing right now, we need to believe that we can be healed. We may feel like we're David in a Goliath world, that we really can't take on the powers of oppression and hatred, but we can if we do justice, if we love kindness, if we walk humbly with our God. So what good is there really that can come from Peace Church in Rochester, Minnesota? Well, I think there's a lot of good, that there's a lot of great peacefulness and love that can be shared for the world around us. So I pray that we would all pray for peace, because there is a star that's dancing in the night, and that star is going to bring goodness and light and love and joy and hope and peace. May God bless you all as we give thanks this day, as you make us one. Amen. God, we thank you for this day that we've gathered together to make us one in spirit and love and hope and peace. God, we just ask that as we come together on this day that you would bless us all on our journey, that you would hold us close to one another, and even in our differences that we would find unity and that we would find peace. As we gather, we lift up all those prayers that are heavy on our heart this day. Many have been unspoken, but from where you are, just lift them up to God and know that God captures them and hears them. Be blessed by God's Spirit this day as we gather. We lift up especially this day prayers for Bob and Danelle Bolio. We lift up prayers for Steve Hallisey and Ed Wagner, for Sue Crowley, for Mary Ely, and Bill Meinhardt. We pray especially for those in our care facilities as well who are in need of your loving, gentle care. For Evelyn Stiller and Doris Underdahl, Joanne Amundsen and Lou Van Gallis, for Audrey Johnson, Ruth Martin, and Russ and Dolores Kelsch. We lift up Ed Rust and Dean Bauk, Linda Frost, Muriel Holly, Bev Morton, and Margie Burrows. And for those who are homebound and just feeling somewhat isolated these days, we lift up especially Betty Allen and Helen Korfitz, Sue Dale, Cal Hawley, and Ed and Mabel Wagner. But most importantly, God, as we gather on this day, we lift up this country, which is so beautiful and so awesome to have in our midst. But we pray for this country now that we're feeling divided and hurt, where we feel like everything is crumbling around us. Help us to find that unity. Help us to be one. Help us to find that love that Dr. King preached about so long ago, where hope is possible and that God's light will shine upon this world. So God, be with us all on our journey. Help us to see that light. Help us to proclaim that good news everywhere we go. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. My friends, as we go from this place, know that God goes with us. Be the light to the world. Go share that joy and that hope for all to see. But most of all, bring peace to one another. Join hands, join love, join peace. And together we will make this world what it is called to be. For we gather as this church each and every day because this is our church.
We make it what it is.
Others will feel welcomed.
If I am welcoming.
It will do great work.
If I work.
It will make generous gifts to many causes.
If I am a generous giver of my time, talents, and treasure.
It will be a sanctuary for social justice and for peace.
If I advocate for marginalized communities, and practice peace in every setting of my life.
It will be a church that embraces all, that builds community, and transforms lives.
If I who make it what it is, practice these things.
Therefore, with the grace of God, we shall rise up, and we shall be a safe and inclusive church, living God's radical message.
And I shall dedicate myself to being all the things I want my church to be. Amen.
Let us go from here, speaking louder than before, louder than ever, because the world needs to hear this song today. Let's go in peace.
Salt preserving these souls. That's the